Hello everyone, welcome to my Resident Evil Village, Village of Shadows difficulty. No damage, no extra content items, no infinite ammo walkthrough. This is House Beneviento. It will start off in the village area. There's going to be a couple of encounters with Lycans. Then we move on to House Beneviento, we take out Beneviento, and then the video will end at the beginning of Moreau's section. Now, I have some good news to report. I was just fighting Miranda today, and I mentioned in the previous video that I didn't really find any kind of strategy that would allow me to do her no damage. From all the videos that I was watching, everyone was using the VZ against her because it's a high-powered weapon, it has a high rate of fire, and I assumed at the time that was the only way I could no damage this, and because I didn't purchase the VZ at the end of this walkthrough, I was probably going to have to avoid this. Well, it turns out that was not the case. What I was doing wrong, for the phase where you have to defend yourself in that little cinematic sequence for the final part of Miranda, is I was supposed to use my sniper rifle, grenade launcher, and magnum in a particular order, and that was what allowed me to do it no damage, which is stupid, but that's what I had to do. And that right there, did you see that just then? This is a mechanic that I stumbled upon in one video, and the guy thought it was a perfect parry, but it isn't. What I did just then is I hit that guy in the head at the correct point in his animation, and he got stunned, but it's not very reliable in the slightest. It's one of the most pointless mechanics in Resident Evil Village, because when are you ever going to get the opportunity to do that kind of counter against the enemies? And furthermore, you have the ability to get grabbed by that attack, and then you can press L1 during the animation to push the Lycan back, and Ethan will just kick him away. But again, it's pointless because there's so many Lycans, and the detection on that move is not very good. That's some Resident Evil 2 Remake inconsistencies right there. Like, for instance, with the tripping mechanic in Resident Evil 2 Remake, whenever you got zombies to walk over dead bodies, there was a percentage of chance that they would actually fall over, but it wasn't very useful at all. It felt like a 1% chance it was going to happen, and I did find a moment in Resident Evil 2 Remake where I was getting that very consistently, but then when I tried to repeat it, it just didn't work. So don't think for a moment that that mechanic that I demonstrated just then is going to be anything reliable in this game. It's not. It's very pointless. I don't know why New Capcom decided to put that in, but it serves no utility at all. It doesn't even do increased damage. Like, the reason why I know this is because of the Mercenaries mode, because when you play Mercenaries mode on this game, the enemies have health bars, and you can see the damage that you're doing to the enemies. And the knife I had was dealing 75 damage to the Lycans, but when I did that counter against him, which was a hard stun on him, so it almost gave the impression that I'm doing increased damage against him during that moment when I perfectly countered him, it didn't do increased damage. So what is the point? Why do you put in such a pointless mechanic? At least in the Enzoi DLC, it made sense. Because if you hit Mutated Jack at the correct point in his animation before his attack actually hit you, it would stun him, and you needed a system like that to balance out Jack's fast nature alongside the dodge system that you could utilize against Jack. And that I can at least understand a mechanic like that existing in, but this game, it doesn't serve any benefit at all. So why it's in this game, I don't know. But don't think for a second it's a perfect guard or a perfect parry. It has nothing to do with like perfectly timing your guard. It's just a weird animation you can put the Lycans in when you perfectly hit them during a certain point in their attack animation. Like, I've gotten that to trigger several times when they've tried to swing at me with their melee weapon, or when they've tried to grab me, but every time I've tried to do it at the exact same point, it has never worked. So don't trust that mechanic at all, don't bother using it, just play the game like normal, and just do everything that I'm demonstrating right now in this walkthrough. And speaking of demonstrations, I watched Carcinogen SDA do a walkthrough of Resident Evil Village on hardcore difficulty, and I found out a lot of interesting things that I didn't realize before. Like, for this section here, when you beat Castle Dimitrescu and you come to this village area, you can actually skip a spawn coming up without having to run down this pathway that I'm using right now. So what you're going to see right here is when I'm running down this pathway, I'm just going to avoid all the enemies that are here. But it turns out, back in that main area of the village, like right near the altar area, there's a fence that you can look through, and you can shoot a lock that is blocking one side of a door. And if you shoot that lock off, when you kill those first two Lycans, and instead of going to the left, you go straight, there's a hole inside of a building you can go into, and because you shot the lock on the other side of the door, it will allow you to skip that spawn that I just ran past. And I'm going to be running past all the spawns here, because I think these Lycan encounters are shit. They attack you ferociously. They don't flinch properly. You don't have the capabilities necessary to deal with them. It's like, why they bothered putting in Lycans in that encounter, and why they put so many of them when the combat systems on Resident Evil Village aren't good? It makes no sense. I mean, Carcinogen SDA dealt with them on hardcore difficulty, but that's only because hardcore difficulty provides some leniency, given that hardcore difficulty works a lot better than Village of Shadows difficulty. But I guarantee you, if you try to replicate Carcinogen SDA strategies on Village of Shadow difficulty, it will not work at all. And Carcinogen SDA did admit that he has not played through Village of Shadows difficulty yet, so he has no idea how much the game is going to change, but having already played Village of Shadows difficulty, I know full well how the game is going to change in the most bullshit ways possible. And Carcinogen SDA agreed with a lot of the points that I mentioned in the previous parts of this walkthrough. He mentioned that Village of Shadows difficulty feels a lot like an RPG game, which is exactly what I feel as well. And we both feel like this difficulty is just badly designed. We both feel like this is an RPG game in disguise. We both feel like the Lycans are shit. Like, we agree on so many points with this game because of just how controversial it is. And so many people don't recognize these controversies because they're too oblivious to these kind of issues, and they're too oblivious to what defines a Resident Evil game. But this game is just filled with a lot of bullshit that needs to be, like, spoken about. And that bullshit is one of the main reasons why I decided to skip those Lycan encounters rather than deal with them. And kudos to Carcinogen SDA for actually having the balls necessary to deal with those enemies, but don't try to do so. It's not going to bode well when it comes to consistency. But we pick up this key here, and this is the end of this part of the village area. We're now going to proceed onward to Beneviento's area, which has no enemies at all. This is where the game is really trying to demonstrate its choice of pacing, and I gotta give credit to the game for actually having the confidence necessary to put in this moment where you're not dealing with any enemies in Beneviento's section. It's just a moment for the game to embrace its more atmospheric side and psychological horror. And I think I really love this part of the game. A lot of people praise Beneviento's section as being the scariest part of Resident Evil Village, and that is true to some extent. I mean, the creepy factor with the baby, and then just really understanding how that relates to Ethan's struggles to actually bring Rose back, and just how much he really embraces his father figure persona. You know, it's depressing in one side. You know, I can't imagine any parent seeing all the innocence gone from their child. It's like with Sebastian from The Evil Within 2. I mean, one of the things that he voiced with Kidman is that he was worried that Lily would have all of her innocence deprived, given the fact that she was in Mobius all this time. She never even got a chance to go to school or really make a lot of friends. So she's been exposed to the darker side of humanity already. And that's just something that Sebastian was really worried about. And they did something very similar to this with this section of the game. And it really allows me to connect with Ethan a lot more. Like, a lot of people say this is one of the most depressing parts of the game here, when you're really trying to understand Ethan at a more personal level, and just the symbolism involved with the baby, and then with Mia, and then with just his father figure persona, as I already explained. It definitely delivers a side of Ethan that I really love, and it makes me love Ethan Winters even more. Not only that, but just seeing Ethan conquer something that the other Resident Evil characters have never, ever had the chance to encounter. I mean, this section here with Beneviento is one of the main reasons why I love Ethan Winters more than the other Resident Evil characters. I mean, I'm just wondering, like, throughout this whole entire time, I mean, this is where Ethan is dealing with serial killers, more so than this organization that's just threatening to destroy the world, or a terrorist organization, this and that. This is a society that really feels a lot like a serial-killing family. And they're not really trying to make world domination their goal. They have a very different goal in mind. Like, world domination must be 10th on their list of priorities. And I'm just wondering what the other Resident Evil characters are doing at this point. They're probably just lounging around at a bar or something, just laughing with each other, having these really nice conversations, thinking they've actually conquered all the evils of bioterrorism, when in actuality, they're complete fools. They're completely oblivious to what's right under their noses, and Ethan Winters has stumbled upon that. And that's just the thing I like about the whole idea of serial killers versus terrorists. A lot of people will say, like, terrorists are worse than serial killers, but serial killers are a lot more secretive, and they are a lot more gruesome in their methodology compared to terrorists. Like, terrorists, they have to go public with everything. They have to make all of their killings very quick, this and that. and they never really get a lot of points where they really show off their more sadistic side, whereas with this, with serial killers, I mean, they're living among us, for crying out loud. These people have been living in secret all this time, doing all sorts of heinous things. They've killed who knows how many people. I mean, if you look at Heisenberg's factory, the amount of soldats that he's made, I mean, how many people, like, how many unfortunate victims stumbled upon this area, and nobody's tried to investigate them? It's one of the things that I really loved about Resident Evil 7, with this new kind of take with Resident Evil, where they're focusing more on these kind of serial-killing families that are very secretive. They kill, like, not as many people as terrorist organizations do throughout the entire Resident Evil series, but imagine if they continued killing. Like, they'd probably kill way more people than Carla would when she unleashed that attack on Lan Chang and on the world in Resident Evil 6. And getting a character like Ethan Winters, who's only encountering BOWs his second time, to actually deal with this kind of bioorganic weaponry and this kind of sadistic nature to these individuals, and he's conquering the psychological horror right now. I mean, we've never seen any other Resident Evil character conquer psychological horror because they've never been exposed to it. They've always conquered biological horror, and we've seen that so many times in the Resident Evil series when it comes to that. I mean, that's just what you're expecting from zombie games or any kind of game dealing with bioterrorism on the more logical side. But when you're dealing with something that involves, like, hallucinations or the psychological horror aspect of bioterrorism, it's a very different side to that fight. And it's just amazing how much Ethan Winters has progressed at this point from dealing with psychological horror in Resident Evil 7 to suddenly doing this. And, you know, just the way he deals with Beneviento and the way he's trying to confront his inner demons, just confronting all the inner struggles that are occurring right now. I mean, he must be thinking about Rose at this point. He must be really thinking about Rose when he's dealing with the baby. And the music that's playing as well, it really makes you want to connect with Ethan and just really understand the terror he's experiencing right now. But when he conquers Beneviento, it feels like he's just accomplished so much more than the other Resident Evil characters. Just the amount of things that Ethan comes across his second time fighting BOWs, like the jump from Resident Evil 7 to Resident Evil Village really is steep. It steeps in craziness. It's incredible just how many different ways the enemies are trying to deal with Ethan Winters on a level that we've never really seen with the other Resident Evil characters in any of the games, really. I mean, so what if you're encountering so many bioorganic weapons in Resident Evil 6 and in Resident Evil 5 and in Resident Evil 4? I mean, it doesn't matter, like, how many they fight, it's the quality of the bioorganic weapons. And, you know, this game really tries to make it seem like the Megamycete is the ultimate bioweapon, and they really capture it here. And then when you have a character like Ethan Winters really trying to cement his place in the Resident Evil universe, and he's doing all these things, all these crazy things, his second time fighting BOWs, it's really uplifting to see a character like Ethan Winters receive such treatment like that. And he's just showing the Resident Evil characters that they can live in their ignorance all they want, but all they're doing is just allowing these kind of individuals to get away with the heinous acts that they're getting away with. And yes, we do see Chris here and there, but he's doing very little in Resident Evil Village compared to Ethan. And I just find it funny when Chris says, "You are out of your depth," when he actually tells Ethan, "You are out of your depth," when you get to Moreau's section. But it's like, he's dealt with the Baker family, he's dealt with Evelyn, one of the most powerful bioweapons ever in the entire Resident Evil series. He's just dealt with Lady Dimitrescu and her daughters, and now he's dealing with Beneviento, and he's like, "You're out of your depth," and then he says, "Stay out of our business," yet he decided to abduct Ethan in the first place, and somehow get him to be somewhere near this village. I just find it very ironic in that sense when Chris says Ethan's out of his depth, yet it feels like he's doing a lot more in such a short amount of time compared to what Chris was going through, not only in this game, but also in the other Resident Evil games. And yes, the kind of enemies he was encountering in Resident Evil 5 and Resident Evil 6 were very deadly. I mean, imagine putting, like, Resident Evil 1 Chris in such a setting in Resident Evil 5 and Resident Evil 6. He would never survive because the bioorganic weapons he encounters are on a whole other level entirely compared to what he's encountered previously. But this is just, this is on a different level entirely, in my opinion. I just think that Ethan Winters has encountered the deadliest BOWs compared to other Resident Evil characters, and they're the ones who are just probably lounging around, just cleaning up all the mess of Resident Evil 6, while all these other serial killing families or these secret societies are going out of their way to make an even deadlier version of a bioorganic weapon. And with just how intriguing this new dimension to Resident Evil is, I'm finding it very hard to go back to the other games. I kind of don't want to leave Ethan Winters behind. Like, Ethan Winters has really delivered a new kind of dimension to Resident Evil through his interactions with the enemies, and we get to see the enemies' perspectives, we get to see the bioorganic weapons perspective, we really get to see this dimension to Resident Evil that's only now being explored in Resident Evil 7 and Resident Evil Village. And it's almost addicting, to a sense, to want to dwell some more in this realm, that I just can't go back to the other Resident Evil games that much. I mean, I'm not finding that urge, really. Like, just the tone of this game, especially. Like, I think this is the bleak Resident Evil game right here. I mean, this game promised it was going to be the darkest and most gruesome Resident Evil game, and it definitely feels bleak in a lot of areas. There's not really a lot of moments that feel very uplifting like there is in the other Resident Evil games, something that really makes you feel upbeat. It's almost like with Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice. A lot of people say that that film is very dark. There's not really a lot of moments where there are just a lot of upbeat moments or jokes being thrown around. It's just very dark for the most part and very serious, and I really feel like this game is the most serious Resident Evil has been. And I think the bleak nature to Resident Evil Village has really affected me personally. Like, when I'm recollecting my experiences with Resident Evil Village, I feel like at times I present as a downer, or I have depression. When I almost feel like I have that inner emotion within me that almost feels like I'm a downer or I'm depressed. And it's something that I've never really gotten with other Resident Evil games. I mean, I've gotten them during certain sections of a game, not through the whole entire game though, because there's always those uplifting moments in the Resident Evil games that really make you forget all the dark things. And, you know, speaking of dark things, this game doesn't have any save room music. I've only just realized that now. There's not really any kind of save room music present with this game. I mean, we only get the merchant's theme when we're in Castle Demetres, but we don't get any other theme when we're with them or when we're near a typewriter. I don't know why there's no save room music in this game. I think that's there to complement the darker nature to this game. Oh, by the way, I just spawned in the baby. When you spawn in the baby by going down that hallway that has the organic matter on the floor, you want to run back and take the alternative way to use the breaker box key and grab that relief of the child, but then you'll want to take this path right here because the baby is actively following you. It doesn't know where you are, but it's just going to be actively going down the same path that you're going, so that's why I'm taking this path right here, and he's actually right in front of me right now, but I'm just going to get right past him because he's very slow. I mean, I should be saying she is very slow, because then again, this is supposed to be some demonic version of Rose to really break Ethan's sanity and really break his mental fortitude. And, you know, it's so crazy that we're doing this in a Resident Evil game. I mean, when I'm thinking of the other Resident Evil games and the other Resident Evil characters, like with Billy or Rebecca or Leon or Chris or Claire or Jill or all those kind of individuals, they never really went through anything like this, anything that personal and anything that, like, demonic, in a sense. It's crazy that they're really bringing this new layer to Ethan Winters, and like I said, it just helps me connect with him emotionally, and I was already connected with Ethan Winters greatly in Resident Evil 7. I really related to him. Just a seemingly normal individual with no fighting experience. Like, I could easily relate to this guy. I could almost feel like I'm this guy right now. And this whole section right here with Beneviento really contributes to that connection with Ethan Winters, and I really love it. Oh, by the way, this part right here, when you spawn in the baby, you don't have to actually do what I'm doing right here. I saw CarcinogenSCA demonstrate a strategy where he spawned in the baby on the section, he ran back into the room, and then the moment he heard a stomp noise indicating that the baby was moving, he went back through the door that allowed him to get inside of this area, and the baby just completely ignored him because he timed it at the right moment where the baby was focused on going through this door right here, rather than attacking him. And this is a pretty helpful strategy for speedrunning. And I didn't realize this at the time because I didn't really do a lot of experimentation with the baby, because this is a very easy section. Why complicate it even more? But it was really interesting that he demonstrated that strategy. Like I said, his walkthrough of Resident Evil Village in hardcore difficulty, I missed a lot. Like, I missed areas that I've never seen before in my blind playthrough and also my repeated playthroughs of Village of Shadows difficulty. I've missed enemies, I've missed treasure, I missed all these really interesting strategies. Like, right here, you don't have to actually go in this room. CarcinogenSCA just stood right by the elevator door, and the baby was very slow to catch him. So he was just standing there. He was just backing up continuously into the door. And he just got in the elevator and nothing happened. So you don't have to do this. Or maybe you do on this difficulty. I don't know if the baby's AI is different on this difficulty or if any of its fundamental parameters are different. But it doesn't feel any different to hardcore difficulty. Maybe it's slightly faster. I don't know. I haven't really tested this out thoroughly. But that is the end of the section. Just imagine what Ethan's feeling right now. Like, escaping this nightmare right here. I almost wonder what would happen if he actually had the capabilities necessary to kill this baby. Just remove the part of him that is feeling very scared about Rose, and just remove the part of him that is really worried about Rose. Or, like for instance, when Sebastian forgave Lily in Chapter 14 of The Evil Within 2, he conquered his inner demons and he achieved inner peace. I wonder if Ethan would achieve inner peace if he actually defeated that baby just then. But we'd never really get the chance to see it. But this is Beneviento's boss fight right now. So, Beneviento, when the fight first starts, she is always going to be up here. I mean, I say Beneviento, this is actually Angie. Beneviento is the one that actually controls Angie. Angie is just one of the puppets that has the Kadu parasite inside, and that's what's allowing her to control Angie right now. I mean, I don't think this is what's happening right now. I mean, I'm not even sure how Ethan kills Beneviento, because in this hallucination, he's using scissors. But when we return to the present and the real world, he doesn't have the scissors in his hand. Did he just choke Beneviento to death or something? Interesting that occurred. But when you stab Angie here, she's going to be back in the living room, and I assumed the position she assumed when she was in the living room was heavily dependent upon the door you went through. So if you went immediately through the door that leads into the living room, her placement would be different, and if you went through this door, she would always be here, but that's not the case. She's either here, or she's right by a cupboard, apparently, right behind me, like somewhere behind me, like near the back of the room. And then this right here, she's either going to go left or right. She went right just then. You can kind of see her go left or right, so you can use that to your advantage. And I think I noticed her going to the right, but I assumed the game was lying, because a lot of games do that, where the AI does one thing, and then they do a completely incongruous action that doesn't really make any sense. And that's what I was assuming here. But it turns out, if you track where she goes, you can pinpoint where she is. She's either back where the elevator door was, or right over here. And you are timed for this sequence. You have plenty of time to find Angie, actually. In my blind playthrough, I failed this part, and I was attacked by the dolls. And they don't actually kill you on hardcore difficulty, which is surprising. But this is the end of Beneviento's boss fight. A very interesting change of pace for Resident Evil Village, where it's trying to show a lot of confidence in not putting so many enemies in front of you and just dealing with one single boss in a gimmick fight. But compared to the shit that I went through with Bella and Moreau, I'm so glad this fight exists. I'm so glad it's not a full-fledged fight, because imagine what New Capcom would have done to make this fight shit. I'm just so glad we never got to see that happen, and they just settled on this, which is really great. And I make a mistake here. With every other boss, you normally get the treasure instantly the moment the fight ends, but with Beneviento, you have to pick up Angie the moment the game gives you control. I didn't do that just then. And if you don't pick up Angie and you leave House Beneviento, you cannot go back inside House Beneviento and pick up Angie. So I lost an opportunity to get a lot of lei from Angie by selling her to the merchant, and you need that lei for this difficulty because of how much it's designed around the merchant system, which I'm going to reiterate for the umpteenth time. It's shit that this difficulty is designed around the merchant system, but I'm not going to flog this dead horse too much unless the opportunity presents itself. But we're now heading back to the village area. And you can go ahead and take the time to pick up any resources around this area. I mean, the area is going to populate with Moriekas, but if you understand the scripting of these enemies, you can pick up certain objects without spawning them in, and then when you return to this area later on, the enemies are gone. And by the way, on Village of Shadows difficulty, they've added lichens to this area. There are two guys with arrows that are present on the bridge that you use to get over here. And I did get a moment where I was damaged by one of them. You can choose to shoot them. I just choose to run right past them. I don't know if it's better to just run past them or shoot them, but considering that you're probably going to be restarting the checkpoint, I think it's just better to save up on your ammunition, in all honesty. But there's the 870 TAC. This right here, you can go over here and you can use the well wheel on this well over here, and you get a Madalena head, which is one half of a treasure. And there's also the ball puzzle in this area right here, if you have the ball. I ran right past the ball. It was back in that area where all the Moriekas were. There's some grenade launcher ammo there. There's the Luthier's key right there. You can use that to access Beneviento's house. It's in the village area. I ran right past it when I was using the Iron Insignia key after that armored lichen. It's a door you probably stumbled upon when you were first going to the village area, but you couldn't open it because you didn't have the knife. You can use it there, and then you can get the customization kit for the sniper rifle that will allow you to have a greater clip capacity. You can also get some treasure and some other resources, and that's very helpful. And that right there, those were the two guys. I don't know the best way to do that. Maybe you can crouch under their arrows. I've experimented with that, and it does work. Because the stronghold encounter with the Lycans, there are a lot of those bow and arrow guys, and I've been practicing deflecting their arrows with a knife. The deflection just isn't that useful, but the crouching can be very handy. It's allowing me to actually deal a lot of damage to them without them actually getting a lot of hits out. So maybe you can use that, and you'll be fine. But I'm back in the merchant. I'm just going to sell everything I have. I'm going to sell the M1911 and also the previous shotgun. I know Carcinogen SDA utilized the M1911 as his main pistol for his hardcore difficulty walkthrough, but the pistol is pretty useless in Mother Miranda's boss fight. I doubt it's going to have much utility in Mother Miranda's boss fight on this difficulty. He used it during that cinematic phase of Mother Miranda's boss fight, and it actually paid off because you can fire it almost as fast as a machine gun when you have the fire rate maxed out. It's insane how fast you can fire it. But I'm not going to use it at all. I get rid of the pistol the moment I start Mother Miranda's boss fight, and I just have the Magnum, the grenade launcher, and the sniper rifle with me, and that's all you'll really need. Maybe I should take the time to experiment with the M1911. I mean, the damage you get at base level is exactly the same as the Lemmy when you have the compensator equipped. The compensator is what you get in Castle Dimitrescu. So I didn't see a lot of incentive to use it, and also a lot of his stats felt kind of inferior to the Lemmy. But maybe when you have all the upgrades, the M1911 is a lot better than the Lemmy. But really, I don't really see a lot of incentive to partake in that whole system. But that is the end of that whole sequence, and I probably should have taken the time to go back to the village area and then pick up that slab that you can get. Because when you beat Beneviento and you go to a certain crypt in the main part of the village area, you'll come across Moriekas, and there's a slab that you can pick up. And if you go back to Beneviento's area, like specifically to that giant grave site, a giant enemy will spawn, but you don't have to deal with it. You can just put the slab down, and then you can get another treasure. I assumed originally you had to kill that guy because I could have sworn during my initial playthrough of that section, I couldn't get the detection to work properly, so I thought I had to kill that guy, the guy with the big axe, who fights very similarly to Urias, but has some slight differences with his movesets. But it turns out you don't have to do that. So take the time to do that in case you need it. I didn't use it here, and I still managed to get the game done, no damage. So there are some treasures that you can skip out on entirely on Village of Shadows difficulty. You don't have to go out of your way to get all of them. I mean, Carcinogen SDA was trying to get all the treasures in his hardcore difficulty walkthrough of Resident Evil Village. But I'm not going to indulge the system further. It's just the part of the farming and grinding that makes finding treasures so tedious. Like, the whole joy of finding treasures in Resident Evil Village should be all about having that urge to do so, not because you're forced to do so. And just, it's one of the main problems I have with Village of Shadows difficulty, and that's all I'm going to say on that. Thank you all for watching, and you take care now.